have you with us. Thank you so much for coming and joining us here on Easter Sunday for our evening service. We've had a great day already. This morning it was standing room only, and it's fantastic to be gathering together and recognizing the Lord who is risen. Over the years, Christians have encouraged one another with a wonderful Easter refrain, and we're going to do the same today. So if you'd stand with me, you guys are going to say the words in yellow. Very good. And we've got an alleluia at the beginning, an alleluia at the end. And alleluia is it's a word that you kind of only meet in church. It means God be praised. Let's praise God. That's really what we're saying here. The amazing miracle of the resurrection, we want to praise God for it. So, alleluia, Christ is risen. He is risen indeed. Alleluia. Praise the God and Father of our Lord Jesus Christ. He has given us new life and hope. He has raised Jesus from the dead. Alleluia. Christ is risen. He is risen indeed. Alleluia. Let's sing.
Lift our voices, sing out alleluia, sing out what you want to do, just in praise of the Lord and then in thanksgiving for what he has done and what he is doing. So Lord, we love you, we worship and adore you. All glory, all honor, all praise to the one who saved my soul. All glory, all honor, all praise, alleluia, you're amazing. Who breaks the power? Who breaks the power of sin and darkness? Whose love is mighty and so much stronger? The King of glory, the King above all kings. Who shakes the whole earth with holy thunder? Who leaves us breathless in all? Above all kings, yeah, this is amazing grace, this is unfailing love, that you would take my place, that you would bear my our chaos back into order. Who makes the orphan a son and daughter? The King of glory, the King above all kings, who rules the nations with truth and justice, shines like the sun in all of its brilliance. The King of glory, the King above all kings. This is unfailing love, that you would take my place, that you would bear my cross, you would lay down your life, that I would be set free. Oh, Jesus, I sing for all that you've done for me. Worthy is the Lamb who was slain, Worthy is the King who conquered the grave. Worthy is the Lamb who was slain. Worthy is the King who conquered the grave. We sing, worthy is the Lamb who was slain. Worthy is the King who conquered the grave. Oh, worthy is the Lamb who was slain. Indeed, but in order to really grasp what we are saved from, we must go back to Good Friday and sing of that awful, awful thing. But it ends well. Let's sing. He stands alone.
He stands alone, a man condemned, deserted by the ones he once called friends. Heaven's King now crowned with thorns. Hosanna's turned to cries of scorn. The crowd demands his crucifixion, though innocent of every crime. The sinless by the guilty tried, God's blameless Lamb led out to die. Jesus died to take my brokenness away.
Yes, he did.
And he rose again to overthrow the grave. So with confidence I stand today and say, it is finished. His weight he's forced to bear, and yet he chose the path that took him there. Pain that pierced his hands and feet, eclipsed by his great love for me. With final breath he cries, it's finished. The temple curtain torn in two, his perfect work is at an end. Our broken bond with God he made. Jesus died. Jesus died to take my brokenness away. And he rose again to overthrow the grave. So with confidence I stand today. Extinguished in a borrowed grave. 3 days passing saw him arise with quick. It's finished, my chains, they're finished. It is finished, my guilt, it's finished. My fear, it's finished. Despair, it's finished. It is finished, my sorrow, it's finished. My suffering, it's finished. My struggles, it's finished. It is finished, my sin. Stand today and say, it is finished. Sing, I was lost in darkness blacker than the night. Now I'm raised with Christ, called a child of light. Yeah. My Savior has the victory in the fight. Praise the one who set me free. Hallelujah. Death has lost its grip on me, because you have broken every chain, and there's salvation in your name, Jesus Christ, my living hope. How great the chasm that lay between us. How high the mountain I could not climb. In desperation, I turned to heaven and spoke your name into the night. Then through the darkness, your loving kindness thought through the shadows of my soul. Did I just say thought? Yes, I did. The work is finished. The end is written. Jesus Christ, my living hope. Who could imagine so great a mercy? What heart could fathom such boundless grace? The God of ages stepped down from glory to wear my sin and bear my shame. The cross is spoken. The cross is spoken, I am forgiven. The King of Kings calls me his own. Beautiful Savior, I'm yours forever. Jesus Christ, my living hope. Yeah. Hallelujah. Praise the one who set me free. Hallelujah. Death has lost its grip on me. You have broken every chain. There's salvation. The promise, your buried body began to breathe. Out of the silence, the roaring lion declared the grave has no claim on. Come on, let's sing that again. Then came the morning that sealed the promise, your buried body began to breathe, and out of the silence, the roaring lion declared the grave has no claim on me. Jesus, yours is the victory. Oh, hallelujah. Praise the Lord. You we find our everlasting life. Can we sing that together? You we find our hope. You we find our peace. You we find our everlasting life. You we find our hope. You we find our peace. You we find our everlasting life. Our everlasting life. Everlasting life. Everlasting
struck with this day is full of celebration, full of joy. But sometimes the Lord is more than just joy. He is a God of all things. And I want you to all know right now that He is exactly what you need Him to be. Possibly even more than you expect. He has all bases covered. There is no situation, no sin, no pain that is too much for Him. He is God of it all. So I encourage you right now to pray to the Lord for exactly what you need. Because in You, Lord Jesus, we find more than we need. Yes, in You, Lord Jesus, we find more than we need.
Amen to that. Do take a seat. And if you've just joined us since we began, let me say a warm welcome to you as well. If we haven't met, my name is John Adams. I'm the vicar here. And thanks so much to Stu and the band for leading us in song. It's wonderful to join together in celebration of the resurrection like that. And let me just echo what Stu was just saying. It may be that the Lord has got particular things for you to really work through this evening, things that you need to pray for, things that are really on your heart that you need His strength, His guidance, His grace for. Please do make the most of this evening. There'll be prayer ministry happening later on at the back there. Do make the most of that. Or perhaps it's the people you've come with, the people who are sitting next to you, who you can talk to about that and pray through it. Just to give you a idea of the shape of the rest of the evening. We have, we're going to join in intercessory prayer in a moment, just bringing our needs to the Lord. Then we're going to just have a little bit of a time of discussion, a chance to just take a break as well, get some refreshments. Then it's lovely to have Stephen Kerwin with us this evening. He got baptized last week. We got an interview with him, a bit of a chance to hear what the resurrection has done for him, what Jesus has done for him. And then John Featherston is going to be picking up our confidence series, those words that we used in that wonderful song, Confidence in the Resurrection. And after we've done that, we're going to join together in the Lord's Supper. We're going to eat the bread, drink the wine, remembering Christ's death on the cross. And remembering that's something that not only secures our pardon, but brings us together as a family. Good. So let me invite Elaine up, please, to come and lead us in our intercessions.
Risen Jesus, please respond, hear our prayer. Loving God, on this Easter day, we celebrate your resurrection. We've just sung about your absolute power over death and evil. And we rejoice and thank you that through your death and resurrection, your saving work is finished. Knowing this, we bring before you the conflicts still continuing in our world, in Israel and Palestine, in Sudan and in the Ukraine. We have heard in the Easter story that you have the power to defeat death and evil, And we ask that we would see your transformation in these places to bring peace and reconciliation. Please change the hearts of those who want domination and revenge, and bring healing and comfort to all those who are suffering. Risen Jesus, hear our prayer. We pray for those who are starving due to war, lack of money, or failure of crops. We pray that much needed food and other basics would get through to them in sufficient quantities. We pray for those who are trying to bring relief, that they would be resourceful and successful and would be protected from harm. Risen Jesus, hear our prayer. We thank you for the beautiful world that you have created. Thank you that we have been able to learn so much more about it and the things that threaten our world and our climate. Thank you for the Emmanuel Climate Group and those who have participated in the Lent Carbon Fast. Please continue to guide them. And please help us all to take action to protect our planet and our world from the threats it faces. Risen Jesus, hear our prayer. Lord, thank you for the Easter services and events at Emmanuel and all the other countries, churches around the country and around the world. We thank you that we were able to join in with our brothers and sisters in Christ to celebrate your resurrection. We pray that you would help each of us to truly understand the meaning of Easter. We pray for believers who are in places where they're not able to celebrate openly for whatever reason, that you would make your presence known to them. We also pray for those that have come to Easter services and events who wouldn't call themselves followers of Jesus. We pray that you would be working in their hearts and lives to bring them closer to you. Risen Jesus, hear our prayer. Amen.
I don't know whether you've had a chance to do it this year. I love going back to the resurrection accounts, and I can really commend it if you've got some moments this evening. Go back, perhaps Luke's gospel, and read through again. Remind yourself of the journey of the disciples. Jesus had died, and they were just absolutely brokenhearted. We thought he was the one, they said to each other, and they cowered, fearful, not knowing what next. In an upper room. And then suddenly, Jesus came amongst them. And what did he say? He said, peace be with you. He said, peace be with you. That's a wonderful picture of what the Lord does actually in all of our lives. He proclaims peace. Peace between us and God because our sin has been taken away and forgiven. Peace between us and one another because there is no longer any reason to be divided from one another. So, may the peace of the Lord be always with you and also with you. Why don't we take an opportunity just to greet those around us? Perhaps there are those who you know well, others who you haven't seen before. Just say hi. Before you dive into that, because I know you're great at doing this stuff, let me just say a couple more things. We got a coffee question. It's going to be up on the screen. It's the first slide, I think, Ian, of the... brilliant, fantastic. There we go. Which words that you've heard have changed your life? Okay, you might want to talk with the people next to you. Which words that you've heard have changed your life? And while you're doing that, do feel free to go and grab some refreshments or just stretch your legs, and then we'll restart in a moment. Okay, good. Well, I can see that there's still a little bit of a queue there, so don't rush too fast. But if you want to just slowly but surely find your places, that would be great. And I'm going to give a warm welcome to Stephen. Stephen, it's lovely to have you here. Thank you so much. So last week, you kindly allowed me to dunk you in our baptistry over there. And you're back for more. Thank you. By the way, if you want to just be encouraged, go back on our YouTube channel and listen to the testimonies from last Sunday in the morning. 10 in a row, including Stephen's. They're fantastic. And we just thought it'd be nice to share a little bit of that here with our evening congregation. So Stephen, just tell us, give us a little bit about your background. Where are you from?
So I'm from Croydon. Lived in Croydon my whole life, except for when I went away to uni. Actually went to the primary school across the road there. I used to come here for carol services, but for most of my life, I did believe I was an atheist.
Right. Yeah. And am I right in thinking that you came to this church for the first time most recently, just a few months ago, or when was it?
Yeah, so it was the end of 2023 that I decided to come. I think it was literally the last service of the year.
And just tell us, you came to one of our kind of Christmas services. Then before you know it, 4 months later, you've got baptized.
Yeah.
Take us through that journey. What happened?
Yeah, so I was sort of at a point in my life where I sort of knew what I should be doing, but I couldn't really explain it. And I searched everywhere, philosophy, science, everything. And then I sort of just started to use the sort of language of God, and I started doing prayer. And then it really felt right. And so I decided, actually, I need to be around people who understand this. So I came to Emmanuel, and then there were so many people and so many conversations, and I was really able to sort of put together a sort of Christian life and a set of Christian views. And then I was able to say one day, I just sort of decided, actually, I think I am a Christian.
It was fantastic, Stephen. I mean, I haven't told you this, but at the time I almost was like, no, you want to go back, and you know, let me come and knock on your door and like explain it to you, and then you can reject me a few times, and then you know, a couple of years down there, and you were like, no, this is it. Absolutely. And we had our classes, you began to explain what an impact Christ had in your life, and it was amazing. Am I right in thinking that you actually did a lot of thinking kind of on your own?
Yeah.
At home? Where were you getting the stuff from?
Yeah, so initially I was reading sort of philosophy, reading books, and then I started to sort of listen to, it was the audiobook version of the Bible on YouTube. I just had that on while I was working from home, and I think I've made it through pretty much most of it, just on audiobook, and I was just listening to it, and it's really started to sort of fit.
That is brilliant. So I don't know whether anyone else is like capable of that kind of multitasking, or just do a day's work and just get the audiobook of the Bible in there. That is amazing, Stephen. Most people are going to want to know how on earth you actually achieve that. That's amazing, but you've got that special skill. You can share that. Now, listen, we need to keep moving because we've got a question for this evening. We've asked everyone else to think about it. John's going to help us think about it in a very specific way in the resurrection. We talked earlier, some words that have changed your life.
Yeah, so the four words I came up with four, hope, will, faith, and worldly, those are the four.
Okay, just tell us about them.
Yeah, so hope, I think it's really nice to actually sort of look to the future, be happy for the future, see that there's a bigger plan, there are bigger things than just me and my troubles. I think it's really sort of refreshing as a message. Mm-hmm. I think will is such an important word, especially in the Lord's Prayer, because it sort of reminds me that actually what I want isn't the most important thing in the world. There is what other people want as well, and then there's also what the Lord wants, which is more important than what all of us want. Mm-hmm. And then...
Worldly. You had your nice little box.
Yeah, so I really like worldly because it's so easy to get sort of caught up in money and all the things that sort of go along with the modern life. But for me, worldly is such an amazing word because it really does contain everything, but it puts it in its own box, which is in a way saying, actually, it's everything, but there's something outside the box. There's something bigger than everything on this world.
Love it. Yeah. And one more.
Faith.
Faith, yes.
Faith, yeah. The ability to just actually let go and say, I sort of trust that things are going to go right. There's a plan. There's something bigger than me. And I'm okay with just letting go.
I love it. Stephen, don't go anywhere. I'm going to pray for you and also pray for those who've been baptized. A real inspiration. Thank you for sharing your testimony. You. Let's pray. Heavenly Father, we thank you for the amazing work that you've done in Stephen and in so many people's lives here through our ministry. The real thrill of seeing how it makes sense of our lives. And Lord, we pray, as Stephen has helped us to say, that we would be people who are able to say, your will be done. And also that we'd be people who have the faith that enables us to trust you, the one who was able to come out of the grave, and therefore know that our lives, our futures do not depend on us. We pray this in Jesus' name. Amen. Should we give Stephen a round of applause? Thank you so much, Stephen. Fantastic. Do ask him afterwards. He's got plenty more to say. He's a great thinker, Stephen. We really enjoyed our classes, and it's been wonderful to learn together on this baptism journey. Now, Michaela's going to come and read for us before John brings our message. Michaela, come.
The reading is taken from Luke chapter 23, verse 50 to 24, verse 12. Now there was a man named Joseph, a member of the council, a good and upright man, who had not consented to their decision and action. He came from the Judean town of Arimathea, and he was waiting for the kingdom of God. Going to Pilate, he asked for Jesus' body. Then he took it down, wrapped it in linen cloth, and placed it in a tomb cut in the rock, one in which no one had yet been laid. It was preparation day, and the Sabbath was about to begin. The women who had come with Jesus from Galilee followed Joseph and saw the tomb and how his body was laid in it. Then they went home and prepared spices and perfumes, but they rested on the Sabbath in obedience to the commandment. On the first day of the week, very early in the morning, the women took the spices they had prepared and went to the tomb. They found the stone rolled away from the tomb, but when they entered, they did not find the body of the Lord Jesus. While they were wondering about this, suddenly two men in clothes that gleamed like lightning stood beside them. In their fright, the women bowed down with their faces to the ground, but the men said to them, "Why do you look for the living among the dead? He is not here. He has risen. Remember how he told you while he was still with you in Galilee? The Son of Man must be delivered into the hands of the sinful men, be crucified, and on the third day be raised again." Then they remembered his words. When they came back from the tomb, they told all these things to the 11 and all the others. It was Mary Magdalene, Joanna, Mary the mother of James, and the others with them who told this to the apostles. But they did not believe the women, because their words seemed like nonsense. Peter, however, got up and ran to the tomb. Bending over, he saw the strips of linen lying by themselves, and he went away, wondering to himself what had happened. This is the word of the Lord.
Kayla, great. Thank you so much for reading that for us. Evening all. If we haven't met a couple of new people with us this evening, it's great to have you here. My name is John. I'm one of the ministers here. And it'd be my privilege just in these next few minutes just to share a little bit with us as we explore together on this Easter Sunday the message that we've just read together. I wonder how you engage with that question. Which words that you've heard have changed your life? That's an important question because some of the best and the worst news that we get in life comes to us in only a few words. We'd love to offer you the job. I'm falling in love with you. Your test results mean you've got the all clear. You're free. Your cancer is gone. Some of us will have heard those kind of words. Others of us, and this might be painful for some of us this evening, will have heard at the opposite end. I'm afraid your job is on the line. I'm sorry, I don't love you anymore. For me, it was the words of my dad and my mum saying that my dad had terminal cancer. And I wonder what words it is for you this evening. Which words have changed your life? Can I say, if you're carrying the weight of heavy words that have changed your life, as John said, there's prayer ministry available later, and any one of us, John, myself, Stu, anyone around here would love to talk with you and journey with you and pray those things through together. But a few words can change the whole of our lives. And there are seven words that can, whatever our circumstances, whatever the words that have changed life for us, there are seven words that can change every one of our lives. Everyone the world over who comes to believe in these words. It's the seven words spoken to the messenger by the messengers to the women at the empty tomb. He is not here. He is risen. Seven words that capture the joy of Easter Sunday. The joy that we heard Stephen speak of just a few minutes ago. See, the message at the heart of Easter is that gloriously there is a way open for each one of us to be in the right with God, received by God, welcomed into his family, receiving the gift of eternal life. Each one of us need that because each one of us in our own ways try and shove God out of the picture of our lives, saying to God that we can call the shots rather than the loving God of the universe. And the reason that's such a problem, the reason that Easter is such good news is because left on our own, that is so serious. God says that it deserves his just judgment, separated from God forever in hell for the way that we've pushed God out of our lives. And so Good Friday brings us the solution to that problem. On Good Friday, we saw Jesus, God in human flesh, hands and feet, nailed to a cross in the most costly, in the most radical love ever known. And why? Well, because of the words we read earlier, we sang earlier. With final breath, he cries, "It's finished." The temple curtain torn in two, his perfect work is at an end. Our broken bond with God, he mends. That's why he went to the cross, so that our broken bond with God could be mended, so that you and I could have an eternal relationship with the God who made us, who loves us, the very thing we were made for. That is Good Friday, and then today, Easter Sunday, brings the message that Jesus' work was not a waste. His resurrection from the dead guarantees that death, the terrible enemy, will not have that last word. It's the news that all who trust in Jesus one day rise to life with him, eternal life, perfect new bodies in a perfect new world. That is the hope of Easter Sunday, that we need not even fear death itself. And that's why those seven words are so vital. He is not here, he's risen. Seven words that can change the whole direction of our lives. Turn our lives around literally, as Stephen's just shared, now walking in a completely different direction to where he was before. And God's done that in many of our lives, and he can do that in your life this evening. Seven words. Now, if all that I've just said is true, we've got to be sure that we can trust those seven words, haven't we? Seven words. He's not here, he is risen. We've got to be sure that we can trust them. And if that's you, you are following Jesus, but you've got lingering doubts, and that's totally fine. Or you're not, and you just wonder, can you trust those words? Well, come with me this evening, And we'll see just some ways that the Easter story helps us have confidence in those words, and then some ways we can respond to those words. Here's the first thing that gives us confidence in those seven words. Jesus, that first Easter, really was dead. Now, I say this because occasionally people try and claim that that one explanation for why Jesus wasn't in the tomb on the third day is that he fainted from the pain on the cross, and then in the tomb he kind of revived and then somehow moved the heavy stone away from the tomb. Now, that doesn't add up, and it doesn't add up for many reasons, but here's one of them. Just before the passage that we read, Luke, he reports that there are multiple witnesses who witnessed Jesus' final moments. So we have the Roman centurion overseeing his crucifixion. We have a whole crowd of onlookers who Luke says had gathered especially to witness this moment. And then a number of Jesus' own followers, including a group of women. We'll meet them again in a few moments. And Luke says that they had followed him from Galilee and that they stood at a distance watching these things. So there's a whole crowd of different witnesses for Jesus' final moments. A whole bunch of people see him breathe his last. Now, if we need more convincing that Jesus really was dead, it's worth just knowing a little bit about this history of this awful practice, crucifixion. You see, horrible as it is, this is a normal part of the day job for a Roman soldier of the day. By the time Jesus has been crucified, the Romans have been using this method for 300 years. In 4 BC, there were 4,000 Jews who were crucified by a Roman general, and there were other mass crucifixions like that in the period around Jesus' life. So the soldiers who crucified Jesus, they knew what they were doing. In fact, we're told in John's Gospel, John's account of Jesus' life, that the soldiers came to break Jesus' legs and the legs of the others crucified with them to hasten the death. But as they came, they discovered he was already dead. And to verify that, they thrust a spear into his side and blood and water flowed out of it. And we know medically that is a sign that the kind of way he died had really happened. The women saw it. The crowd saw it. The soldiers overseeing his death made sure it happened. And they saw it. Jesus really was dead. Second, Jesus really was buried. He was dead, and so he needed to be buried. And Joseph of Arimathea, he comes to Pilate and he asks permission. We pick up the narrative in verse 53. If you've still got it open, do look with me. Then he took it down, that's Jesus' body, wrapped it in a linen cloth, and placed it in a tomb cut in the rock, one in which no one had yet been laid. It was preparation day, and the Sabbath was about to begin. The women who had come with Jesus from Galilee followed Joseph and saw the tomb and how his body was laid in it. Notice the very specific details. Body wrapped in a linen cloth, placed in a previously unused tomb, cut in the rock, just before the Sabbath began, as the sun was beginning to set. Just the kind of specific detail that could only come from people who were there. And we know that from the start of Luke's gospel that he'd said that he had carefully gathered all these different eyewitness accounts to make up his gospel. Indeed, he got many of them directly from talking to the eyewitnesses. If you want to hear more about that, the sermon from 2 weeks ago, 17th of March, a bit more on how we can trust the eyewitnesses in the New Testament. Jesus really was dead. Jesus really was buried. And third, Jesus' body really wasn't there on the third day. Here's how chapter 24 that we had read begins. On the first day of the week, very early in the morning, the women took spices they had prepared and went to the tomb. They found the stone rolled away from the tomb, but when they entered, they did not find the body of the Lord Jesus. Again, do you spot the very specific details that could only make sense if they came from people who'd seen it? Early in the morning, very early in the morning, stone rolled away, no body of Jesus in the tomb. The same women who'd witnessed Jesus' body laid in that tomb now find the very same tomb, stone rolled away, and Jesus' body nowhere to be seen. Now, it says just before this in chapter 23 that the women saw the tomb and how his body was laid in it. Now, the word there for saw is a word that means to look intently. In other words, to really take something in. Now, I say that because some people have claimed that on the Sunday morning, it was early in the morning, and maybe the women kind of mistook this tomb for another tomb. Lots of burial places in and around this part of Jerusalem. So it's possible that they went and they saw a different tomb. But no, these witnesses, we're told, they paid careful attention. They looked intently. They knew where he'd been laid. They knew how he'd been laid in the tomb. We're told Mary Magdalene, Joanna, Mary the mother of James, and the others with them, they step into the tomb, that same tomb, and find it empty. Now, one reason that this testimony of the women is so compelling, and the way that Luke records it here is so compelling, is that, frankly, women in Jesus' day were not regarded as reliable witnesses. Their testimony wasn't accepted in a court of law. It wasn't viewed as legally binding. And although in many ways we're further on than that in our society, it's not like every sexist attitude is a thing of the past, is it? And I just want to say as a sort of side note, but I think it's important from this. If you as a woman have ever felt demeaned, put down, not listened to by men, and you've got the strong impression it's simply because you're not a man. Well, this is wonderful. Jesus honored in the whole of his ministry and treated women with such equality, such dignity. And then he makes sure that he appears to these women, the first people who see him risen. Now, that is a huge encouragement. It means he knows and he cares about your struggles. It means you have in the Lord Jesus one who will never put you down, diminish your value or your contribution. But the sad fact is, winding back to that time, that the women's testimony just wasn't believed. And that makes it extremely unlikely that these writers, the New Testament writers, would have made up this story of the resurrection. Because, to be honest, if you were trying to make a story sound credible, the very last thing you would do in Jesus' day would be to say it was based on the testimony of women. If the gospel writers had been sort of making it up from scratch, they would not have written it that way. But they did. And that's compelling. It's because Jesus' body really wasn't there. In 2010, I had the great privilege of spending a couple of weeks, one summer, working in the Garden Tomb in Jerusalem. Jerusalem, Israel, obviously much in the news at the moment. If we can just look past that this evening for a moment. The Garden Tomb, it's one of a couple of the sites, possible sites, where people have said Jesus might have been crucified and buried here. We don't know. But it's a wonderful place to visit. It was a wonderful privilege to volunteer. And each day, those of us who are volunteering there would take it in turns to clean different parts of the site. And I remember one very vividly early one morning. I was on tomb sweeping duty. So I was sweeping on the inside of the tomb and then the kind of area around. And after I'd finished, I just had a few minutes. And I couldn't help just kneeling in that spot, looking at the tomb, and wondering, could this be the place? Could this be the place where my Lord Jesus was laid? And then I kind of had to kind of reel myself in for that, because I had to remember what we used to say to every tour group who we brought round. There, we would explain, we just didn't know for sure. Is it the Garden Tomb? Is it somewhere else in Jerusalem? The Holy Sepulchre Church, that's where traditionally the site that people have thought. And I had to remind myself, that doesn't really matter. What matters is the truth of the words on the door of the tomb, those eternity-changing words. He is not here. He's risen. And that is the claim we're examining right now. Just track with me, we've seen Jesus really was dead, he really was buried, he really wasn't in the tomb on the third day. And lastly, last thing to give us confidence in this seven-word message, Jesus really did appear. After the bit of Luke's gospel that we read of Jesus appearing to a whole bunch of people. He comes to two disciples on the road to Emmaus, one of them's called Cleopas. The other one's not named. And that's almost certainly because only Cleopas was still around at the time Luke wrote. And the reason that Luke tells us that he's still around, that he names him, is so that people could go and ask Cleopas and check out the story that Luke wrote. And then, so Jesus appears to those two disciples. Then he appears to his 11 apostles and to all the other disciples who are with them. He shows them the nail marks in his hands and his feet. He even eats some of the fish that they have there with them in their presence. That's significant because it shows this is not a ghost. This is not a hallucination they're seeing. Sometimes people try to claim that that's what happened with the resurrection appearances, but a hallucination can't eat your lunch. Jesus appears to Cleopas, he appears to this other disciple, he appears to the apostles, all those with them, and then we're told by the apostle Paul, writing about 20 years after this, he says that Jesus also appeared to more than 500 men and women at the same time, most of whom were still living at the time he was writing, and who could therefore confirm what they'd seen. People could go and ask them. Now, again, it feels pretty unlikely, nigh on impossible, that 500 people would have the same hallucination about seeing the risen Jesus. Even more unlikely that a number of those people would go on to die proclaiming right until their final breath that Jesus died and rose again for them. Pretty unlikely if they only thought that they maybe saw the risen Jesus. You see, at every point, the most plausible explanation for the events of Easter weekend is just the explanation that Luke gives us in these words. He is not here. He is risen. Jesus really was dead. Jesus really was buried. Jesus really wasn't there on the third day. And Jesus really did appear. Now, that is all very well, isn't it, in theory? But Jesus doesn't tell us this through his apostles, just so we can kind of agree or not agree to the facts of the resurrection. He tells us because these seven words can shape our eternities. And so, in our final few minutes together, I just want us to help us think about three different ways we might be responding to this news. Here's one possible response. Joyful belief. Joyful belief. The men in white, they bring those eternity-changing words to the women, and we're told that verse 8, the women remembered Jesus' words. That is Luke's way of saying that they clocked that Jesus really had both died and then risen again for them, just as he'd said to them time and again that he would. They remembered that clear prediction of his death and resurrection, and they believed. They thought, yes, he's really not there. He really is risen. And because of that, we hear from Matthew's account that the women hurried away from the tomb, he says, afraid yet filled with joy, and ran to tell his disciples. The penny dropped, and so they were filled with joy. And if the penny has dropped for you this Easter, whether decades ago or more recently, Easter Sunday brings us back again to the sheer joy of this life-shaping, eternity-changing truth. Right now, you and I, who have believed in Jesus, we know the words that we've been singing, that death really is defeated, that resurrection really is coming for us, that as Stu was praying and indicating to us, there is no situation in our lives that is ever truly hopeless. However difficult those things feel to you now, and there are one or two, I imagine this evening, for whom situations are just so difficult, they're going on so long, and you wonder if they could never end, if they would ever end. The resurrection, Easter Sunday, gives you an unshakable hope. The hope that we've sung of, one of the songs we've sung already, is based on these glorious words. Let me just read a couple of words at the beginning of 1 Peter. Peter says, "Praise be to the God and Father of our Lord Jesus Christ. In his great mercy, he has given us new birth into a living hope through the resurrection of Jesus Christ from the dead and into an inheritance that can never perish, spoil, or fade." Hallelujah, Christ is risen. The response is, he is risen indeed. Hallelujah, we can do a lot better than that. Hallelujah, Christ is risen. He is risen indeed. Hallelujah. That is the first response to this news, joyful belief. Here's the second reaction, a very different one. And it might be where some of us are this evening. Dismissive disbelief. verse 9. When they came back from the tomb, they told all these things to the 11 and to all the others. It was Mary Magdalene, Joanna, Mary the mother of James, and the others with them who told this to the apostles. But they did not believe the women because their words seemed to them like nonsense. Well, the story goes on. We know that these same disciples, they do come to encounter the risen Jesus and to believe. But in this moment, that is not the place they're at. They hear this story of the women that they bring to them, and their attitude is this one of dismissive disbelief. It seemed to them like nonsense, Luke says. And it might be that you find yourself in a similar position this evening. You hear this talk of Jesus rising physically from the dead, defeating death, offering a way to eternal life, and frankly, it sounds to you like nonsense. If that's you, I don't blame you. It's a massive claim. It deserves serious thought. It's a claim I've tried to give a taster of tonight, the reasons why millions of Christians the world over and down the centuries have come to believe this claim. But it is worth serious thought and investigation for you. And it might be that the right response for some of us this evening is just to be open, at least open to exploring this possibility for ourselves. Can I just urge you simply this Easter weekend not to dismiss this out of hand, but to be prompted this Easter to explore the story for yourself if you've never seriously done that before. There are three ways different simple ways that you could do that. At the back, after the service, I'm going to be around just by that door. And I'm going to have a couple of things. I'm going to have this little booklet here, which just very simply explains the message of Easter weekend in a fresh way. We would love to give you one of those. Or maybe you have further questions to take on the kind of things that we've been hearing about this evening. This is an excellent book, Is Easter Unbelievable? Exploring in more detail the evidence for the resurrection. We would love to give you a free copy of that. Please don't be offended if I push one of those into your hands at the end as a gift for you this Easter. And so that's another way you could respond. And then just after Easter, we're gonna run a course exploring the Christian faith. If you would be interested in that, please talk to me or to John or to Stu, or get in touch with us through the church office, and we'll give you details of that. And it'll be a wonderful way to ask any questions that you have about faith in Jesus. I just say that to you because if there's just a chance that this is true, wouldn't you want to explore that? If there's just a chance that the Lord Jesus really is risen and that eternal life really is a possibility for you with the God who made you and loves you, wouldn't you want that? So don't go for dismissive disbelief. What step could you take next to explore this news? And here's the final reaction from our passage. And it's going to lead us into a prayer in a few moments. And then after that, into taking communion. And John will explain more about that. Here's the third response. Honest questioning. So we're at this point, the disciples have dismissed the news out of hand, but there's one of them who can't shake off the feeling that there is more to this report from the women. And so verse 12, Peter, however, got up and ran to the tomb. Bending over, he saw the strips of linen lying by themselves, and he went away, wondering to himself what had happened. He goes to the tomb, he sees the strips of linen lying by themselves, and he goes away wondering. And it wouldn't be long before Peter would encounter the risen Jesus himself and would believe. And the New Testament shows us that step of belief that he made radically transformed his life. This simple fisherman becoming the one through whom God, Jesus, would begin to build his church. His church that is still going and growing strong over 2,000 years ago, including here this evening. But first, he had to take that step of belief. And it may be that some of us are here this evening or watching online, and you're ready, you're in the place that you're ready to take that step. You've seen the evidence. Perhaps this talk is just confirmed for you again. The resurrection is credible. It's compelling. You can't see any other logical explanation for the empty tomb other than that Jesus really did rise from the dead. And so you're in the place where you're ready to make a commitment to follow Jesus. If that is you, can I say to you that I'm going to end in a moment with a prayer. And it's a prayer that you can pray for yourself in the silence of your heart. And there is no better time than the present for you to make this commitment to follow the Lord Jesus in response to those 7 life-changing, eternity-changing words, to put your trust in him and receive the gift of eternal life. It might be there's something that has been holding you back, but tonight might be the time to make this decision and follow Jesus. So as I close, I'm going to read for us a prayer. It's a prayer of confession. It's one that all of us can use as we prepare our hearts for communion. If we're someone this evening who's already trusted the Lord Jesus, you can pray this prayer in the silence of your hearts when I pray it as a form of confession. But if you're here this evening and you know that you're compelled by what you're hearing of the Lord Jesus, and you want to take that step of putting your trust in him, of having your sins forgiven, and receiving this gift of eternal life with the God who made you, the very thing that you were made for. If you're ready to do that, you can say these words in the silence after me. I'm going to read it through once more quickly and then once slowly, so that the first time so you have time to hear what you'd be praying, and the second time so you can repeat in the silence of your heart after me. So Almighty God, Heavenly Father, I have sinned against you and against my neighbor in thought and word and deed, through negligence, through weakness, through my own deliberate fault. I am truly sorry and repent of my sins. For the sake of your Son, Jesus Christ, who died for me, forgive me all that is past and grant that I may serve you in newness of life to the glory of your name. Amen. Let's pray, and I'll pray that more slowly, and it might be that someone is in a place to make this decision. And if you are, and if you say these words, pray this prayer, please come and talk to us, to John, myself, to Stu, one of us in the team. We would love to help you as you begin your journey of faith. So Almighty God, Heavenly Father, I have sinned against you and against my neighbor in thought and word and deed, through negligence, through weakness, through my own deliberate fault. I am truly sorry and repent of my sins. For the sake of your Son, Jesus Christ, who died for me, forgive me all that is past and grant that I may serve you in newness of life to the glory of your name. Amen.
Well, as John said, we now come to share the Lord's Supper. This is the way that Jesus himself gave us to remember him by. And as we drink the wine, as we eat the bread, we're in a very physical and very tangible way expressing our faith in him. This is by taking these elements, we are saying, yes, I trust in you. So we invite anyone this evening who is in that place, you're trusting in the Lord, you've given your life to him, you're trying to follow him, to come and take of the bread and the wine. It's going to be distributed at 2 points here on the left and here on the right. You'll be directed on each side when the time comes. If you're not sure whether that's you this evening, you're welcome to come up with your hands by your side. Someone will pray for you, or indeed, if you just want to remain where you are in the pew and just quietly pray, you're welcome to do that as well. So please do join in the words in yellow. The Lord is here. His Spirit is with us. Lift up your hearts. We lift them to the Lord. Let us give thanks to the Lord our God. It is right to give him thanks and praise. It is right to praise you, Father, Lord of all creation. In your love, you made us for yourself. When we turned away, you did not reject us, but came to meet us in your Son. You embraced us as your children. and welcomed us to sit and eat with you. In Christ, you shared our life, that we might live in him and he in us. He opened his arms of love upon the cross and made for all the perfect sacrifice for sin. On the night he was betrayed at supper with his friends, he took bread and gave you thanks. He broke it and gave it to them, saying, "Take, eat. This is my body, which is given for you. Do this in remembrance of me." Father, we do this in remembrance of him. His body is the bread of life. At the end of supper, taking the cup of wine, he gave you thanks and said, "Drink this, all of you. This is my blood of the new covenant, which is shed for you for the forgiveness of sins. Do this in remembrance of me." Father, we do this in remembrance of him. His blood is shed for all. As we proclaim his death and celebrate his rising in glory, send your Holy Spirit that this bread and this wine may be to us the body and blood of your dear Son. As we eat and drink these holy gifts, make us one in Christ, our risen Lord. With your whole church throughout the world, we offer you this sacrifice of praise and lift our voice to join the eternal song of heaven. Holy, holy, holy Lord, God of power and might, heaven and earth are full of your glory. Hosanna in the highest. We break this bread to share in the body of Christ. Though we are many, we are one body because we all share in one bread. We invite those who are going to distribute the elements to come forward as we say this prayer together. Draw near with faith. Receive the body of our Lord Jesus Christ, which he gave for you, and his blood, which he shed for you. Eat and drink in remembrance that he died for you, and feed on him in your hearts by faith with thanksgiving. So we come to the Lord's table. We come not because of the merits that we bring, not because of our moral performance, not because of the good record of our deeds, but because of his righteousness. The Lord Jesus' perfect life that was lived for us, his death given for us, so that we might be seen as if we were him. We do not presume to come to this your table, merciful Lord, trusting in our own righteousness, but in your manifold and great mercies. We are not worthy so much as to gather up the crumbs under your table, but you are the same Lord, whose nature is always to have mercy. Grant us therefore, gracious Lord, so to eat the flesh of your dear Son, Jesus Christ, and to drink his blood, that our sinful bodies may be made clean by his body, and our souls washed through his most precious blood, and that we may evermore dwell in him, and he in us. Amen.
to Jesus I surrender, to him I freely give. I will ever love and trust him in his presence daily. I surrender all. I surrender all. Oh, to thee, my blessed Savior, I surrender. To Jesus I surrender, make me Savior holy thine, let me feel the Holy Spirit truly know that thou art thine. I surrender. Savior, I surrender.
Should we stand together? Sing one more song of the risen Christ. Behold, my Savior is risen from the dead. To hide you was rolled away, revealing the triumph of my Lord, the tomb laid bare. My heart cries hallelujah, hallelujah. Jesus has won, sin has fled. My heart cries hallelujah. From the dead,
I've seen the risen Savior with wounds upon his hands, the marks of death he gave to Calvary. I believe that he saved me, and I am overwhelmed by what he did for me upon that tree.
What you love most, your only precious son, broken and bled. But the grave couldn't keep you, the tables have been turned. Behold, my Savior's risen from the dead. Oh, my heart cries hallelujah, hallelujah.
Brilliant, brilliant. Thank you so much, guys. Cheers, man. Thank you for leading us. Do take a seat. Let me just share a couple of notices with you before we wrap up. First of all, let me just find my notes here. If you would like to take things further, as John mentioned, do grab some of those tracts. Great to share with others as well. Little presentation of the Easter message at the doors. Also, if you would like to join our
course, Exploring Christianity, coming up in the next couple of weeks or so. We'd love to hear from you. Do get in touch with me, Stu, John, one of the team. We would love to connect you with those who are leading that, a chance to explore the Christian faith further. 2 days ago, the song that we sang today, It Is Finished, was released on our streaming platforms. Please do make the most of it. It's a fantastic song. It expresses so wonderfully. Oh, what do you want? You want to wait? Oh, yes, very good. Yeah, good. Right. In fact, what you can do is pick up one of these lovely little postcards. It's got a QR code on it, so you can go straight to where you can find it, something you can share with others. Do share it online, on your social media and stuff. We would love this song to be enjoyed by others. It's a wonderful expression of what the Lord Jesus achieved on the cross. So do make the most of that. Now, one more thing, which is a bit of a procedural thing, but I've got to share it with you, so just bear with me. We have got our annual meeting on the 12th of May. That means that we've got to revise our electoral roll, that's like our membership here, before then. Now, the current electoral roll is up on the board out by the foyer, so please could you, if you think you're on it, or you think you should be on it, go and check that you are, that the details are correct. If you would like to join the electoral roll and therefore register your membership of the church, you need to do that in order to be able to vote at the annual meeting. Please do grab one of the forms out there and put it in the white post box by the office there. And do consider standing for the elections. That's to the PCC, the church council, or indeed to the role of warden. Good. Well, it's been a fantastic evening. We have drunk deeply of the wells of God's grace and power in the resurrection. So let's close with a final prayer. Heavenly Father, we thank you that the resurrection is true today, tomorrow, in the midst of the week ahead, all the way through the deepest challenges that we may face in the coming days, weeks, months, whatever else we're going through. Lord, we pray that you would go with us and that confidence in the resurrection would go with us and that through it you would help us fix our eyes on Jesus, the pioneer of our faith. So may God, who through the resurrection of our Lord Jesus Christ has given us the victory, give us joy and peace in our faith, and the blessing of God Almighty, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit be among us and remain with us always. Amen. Thank you so much for joining us this evening. Do stick around for some hospitality. We'd love to see you there. If you'd love someone to pray with you, do head over into the far corner for some prayer ministry. It was my turn till I met you. I was breathing.